एंड आजादी का अमृत महोत्सव। टॉपिक ऑफ टुडेज वेबिनार इज डेवलपमेंट ऑफ द फर्स्ट ओरल कोलेरा वैक्सीन एंड इट्स सक्सेसफुल टेस्टिंग ऑन ह्यूमन वॉलेंटियर्स। फॉर द पास्ट 8 डिकेड्स CSIR with its network of 37 laboratories is proudly serving the nation in almost all major domains of science and engineering, which have largely touched our day-to-day life. Through this webinar series, we are showing the journey of 80 years of CSIR. People across the world have very recently seen and faced the outbreak of the deadly COVID-19 pandemic, due to which almost every one of us in this era know what a pandemic is and how development of a vaccine is critically important. But COVID is not the first ever pandemic. Our country and many other countries have faced outbreak of other diseases as well. The very well known is the cholera outbreak. Just like COVID, for the protection against cholera and for its prevention and control, development of effective vaccine was very essential. We have seen the enormous participation and contribution of research laboratories in development of vaccine for COVID mitigation. But again, this is nothing new, that laboratories have shown their capabilities to tackle situations as deadly as pandemics. Our laboratories have been working since years to bring solution to fight with global public health problems such as cholera, COVID, and other diseases. One such lab is the Indian Institute of Chemical Biology, CSIR IICB, situated in Kolkata. The institute was established in 1935 as the first non-official center in India for biomedical research and was included within the aegis of CSIR in 1956. The laboratory today is engaged in research on diseases of national importance and biological problems of global interest. CSIR IICB is one of the major laboratories in India which initiated multidisciplinary concerted efforts for conducting basic research on infectious diseases, specifically leishmaniasis and cholera. Today, we are honored to have with us leaders from IICB who will discuss about the development of the first ever cholera vaccine in India and its successful testing on human volunteers. We have with us Director CSIR IICB, Dr. Arun Bandopadhyay, Dr. Shyamal Roy, Emeritus Scientist CSIR IICB, and Dr. Shiv Shankar Roy, Senior Principal Scientist CSIR IICB. I am Dr. Shikha with you, your moderator and scientist from Science Communication Directorate at CSIR Headquarters. So without further ado, I would like to begin with our talk and bring to our audience the story behind the successful development of the first oral cholera vaccine. So all the online friends who are connected with us, kindly post your queries and comments in the chat box of the social media web pages. We shall be taking those questions live at the end during the discussion. So we shall begin with the talk by Director CSIR IICB, Dr. Arun Bandopadhyay. First of all, I would like to introduce Dr. Arun Bandopadhyay. Dr. Bandopadhyay completed MSc from Vishwa Bharati University and MTech from IIT Kharagpur and did his PhD in molecular endocrinology and worked as a postdoctoral fellow in South Korea and also as a visiting scientist in University of Cincinnati at USA. He has been working as a scientist with IICB for the last 21 years and has raised to the level of director of the institute. His research interest includes cardiovascular and respiratory diseases and has more than 50 research publications and several patents granted in his name. He is a fellow of the National Academy of Sciences and also the fellow of West Bengal Academy of Science and Technology. With this, I invite Dr. Bandopadhyay to kindly deliver the opening remarks and also inform us about the cholera vaccine development at IICB through his talk. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Shikha. It was a very nice beginning and very nice introduction for this talk. It's my privilege and it's our privilege, IICB's privilege, to share the story, share the success story of IICB. And we are thankful to CSIR, CSIR headquarters, and you and your team for including this as one of the success stories of CSIR. We have enlisted among 80 success stories of CSIR. It is also very nice to present our story in the occasion of our celebration of 75 years of India's independence, which is called Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. And my talk is dedicated for this Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. We are celebrating Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav in several ways. This is one of the ways which is decided by CSIR, and we'll talk about this. So basically, this is a very informal presentation. It's not a tech lecture or talk. This is a story. The story should be heard by many people who have not, who don't know about the vaccine development. And now it is very relevant nowadays, as you have discussed, that because now people are living with the vaccine. We are dependent on the vaccine, but it happened earlier in the history. IICB has actually developed some concept, and which the concept was not thought of at that time by people, by Homo sapiens. But IICB is a pioneer, so that's why people should know that. And I'm privileged that you are giving this opportunity to share this. So let me share my presentation. So my slides are visible?
Sorry. Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay, so the topic of this talk is development of the first oral cholera vaccine and its successful testing on human volunteers. And I have already told that the talk is dedicated for India's 75-year celebration of independence, and we say the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. So basically, we'll discuss about three things. Number one, we'll end with the cholera vaccine trial in human volunteers, including the inventors who tested among themselves. And before that, I'll tell about how CSR IICB was established, and what is the perspective at that time. So Calcutta. So let me start with Calcutta first. So just make this slide. So many people know that Calcutta has a connection with Nobel laureates. Many Nobel laureates of India and of the world are connected to Calcutta. Many are born here, many got work, many work there, and many of them Nobel Prize from working in India. So many of you, but many of the people know that they don't know about the success story or the Nobel Prize story in the earlier days from the people who worked in Calcutta. So two of such people, Sir Ronald Ross and Robert Koch, they are very relevant for this topic because they worked in the two major diseases in India. One is malaria and another cholera. So during the late 19th century, two giants of the microbe hunters, they called the microbe hunters because they did their research on microbes. They used to find out the microbes, they track the microbes. They work in Calcutta. Ronald Ross and Ronald Koch worked on malaria transmission at the Presidency General Hospital and on cholera at the Medical College respectively. So Dr. Ronald Ross, he worked in malaria and in the Presidency General Hospital, and Robert Koch worked in cholera in the Medical College. Incidentally, Charles Donovan, co-discoverer of Leishmania Donovani, was also born in this city in 1835. So Ronald Ross Ronald Ross developed the malaria. He discovered the malaria and the parasites, and they got the Nobel Prize in 1905. Koch worked in the cholera. So Dr. Koch he's a German, and he came from Germany. Donald Ross, born in India, worked in India, but he died in London. And Dr. Koch worked, he was from Germany. He actually worked in Egypt in cholera, to run the cholera. But finally, when cholera was controlled in Egypt, he was shifted to India. So this shows that he is working with his colleague, Frederick Jonathan Pfeiffer, in the cholera outbreak in Mumbai. But most of the time he worked in Kolkata. So one of the writings we have collected that it shows that he migrated from Egypt to Calcutta. It took 4 weeks. And some of the sentences I'll read out, which will show how he got the facility in Calcutta at that time, in 1985 onwards. The party was made by the British authorities, and excellent laboratory facilities were placed at disposal at the Medical College Hospital. The laboratory room that were given was on the second floor of the building, adjacent to a hospital, because they need a hospital. room had three large windows so that it was quite favorable for microscopical studies. But the windows are equipped with blinds which could be closed to keep the sun out so that the room kept fairly cool. At that time, you cannot think of AC. A number of tables, chairs, and cabinets were available, making it possible for the group to set up all their laboratory equipment. The laboratory even had running water and combustion gas. So they were very fortunate to have all these facilities. For studies on experimental animals, a stall in the basement was available, and a chemical laboratory was also placed at their disposal. The autopsy room was nearby. So this is very interesting, so because Dr. Koch used to do a lot of autopsy. So autopsy room was also available, facilities also available. And during autopsy, he actually discovered the cholera bacteria. So he collected samples from the endemic region. And he showed that there is a toxin released from the bacteria. But before that, Somnath Day, he actually showed that cholera toxin was he discovered cholera toxin. So at that time, this gentleman, Dr. Koch, also found that bacteria is the causative agent, and bacteria releasing some toxin in the patient. So that could be the problem. But before that, Somnath already published it. So these two people, that Dr. Koch got Nobel Prize, however, Somnath, they didn't get Nobel Prize on this malaria, cholera discovery. So this is the picture for what was Museum Berlin regarding the cholera epidemic in Calcutta. It states that the common water source may cause disease spread. So this was this is from the Berlin Museum. And I'll just show some of the lines, how much time used to take from to come to India from Egypt, from Germany, because he came from Egypt. It was until the middle of February that the weather became so warm that the gelatin cultures could not be prepared. On the way to India, he's writing to his wife that on the way to India, Koch wrote his wife from the Suez Canal, that 10th November 1883, that we are here in Suez writing a ship to take us to India. The ship will apparently came in the morning, and then we'll come in the morning, and then it will be born. We'll be on our way. First, we'll go to Colombo, that is Sri Lanka. Now they are on the island of Ceylon, Sri Lanka, where we will spend several days and try to recover from the 2-week sea voyage, and then onto Calcutta, which will take another 5 to 6 days. I think that we will arrive in Calcutta in the middle of December. Today, I also wrote to Trudy and study his daughter, and sent her stamps, flowers, and mosquito. So that she can learn a little about the dark side of the Orient, because mosquito was very common in those days. So that was the perspective. So in that condition, so in 1935, CSIR IICB was born. IICB started its journey from a small house in central Calcutta as an institute, as Indian Institute of Medical Research. It was named as Indian Institute of Medical Research, not IICB. It's III, IIMR. It was in 1935. It was founded by Dr. J.C. Ray and his young clinicians colleagues like H.N. Ghosh, A.C. Ukil, and Navajivan Banerjee. The aim of the institute was to conduct research on biomedical sciences, both in basic and applied aspects. There was a need to investigate health problem of the country. Needless to mention that it was the first non-official medical research institution in India with a very small budget coming from private donation. It is integrated in CS 1956. So Dr. J.C. Ray and his young clinician, the friends they saw in Calcutta Medical College, that people are dying because of cholera, leishmania, and malaria. So they thought that should be a research institute for conducting research so that they can find out the causative agents, they can find out the biology, and then where there's any control therapeutic, they develop therapeutic strategy. So that was the purpose, and that was a nationalistic attitude that they built their institute with their own money. So this is the team, the Dr. Jyotish J.C. Ray with his friends. J.C. Ray born on April 1899, enrolled for medicine at Frederick William University, Sherit, on November 22, 1923. So this picture, what is it? J.C. Ray here. Barnard Nosh Institute for Tropical Medicine in 1927 batch for tropical medicine. So this circle showed Dr. J.C. Ray. So at that time, as I said, that as a nationalistic feeling was there because they wanted to have their own institute controlled by them. So that's why they donated their own money. And the Rabindranath Tagore appealed to the people, the establishment of such a well-conceived center for medical research depends upon adequate donations and endowment received from the public. Let me entreat my fellow countrymen for a ready response to this appeal for assistance for this institution that through their support they make a real success, unquote. So Acharya P.C. Rao also requested wealthy people to generously respond and help the institute. Along with biomedical research on infectious disease, they established a diagnostic laboratory and a clinical unit, but earning was not very good because they thought that there should be a source of income also so that they can sustain the research. So that was, this is the Calcutta Medical College at that time. Now, let me share the chronology of events, very important events. In 1935, Indian Institute of Medical Research was born, which I now wish say IICB. It was established not in this campus, that in other place. In 1941, publication of new journal, Annals of Biochemistry and Experimental Medicine was made by IIM. 1956, it was integrated into CSIR. 1964, WHO identified this institute as the International Center for Cholera Phage Typing. That's a very interesting point. I'll show you later. 1967, oral vaccine against cholera tried in human. This was landmark incidents in the history of mankind. 1982, the name is changed to Indian Institute of Chemical Biology. 1988, UNDP funded program on Leishmania parasite research was received. So the major research work in early years until late 70s was protozoa and immunology, bacteriology, biochemistry and nutrition, chemistry and immunochemistry and chemotherapy, diagnostic service. So all these the topic are very essential. And we can now understand that how important was understanding protozoa and immunology and also bacteriology. So now I'll discuss about cholera research at CSIRICB. Dr. H.N. Ghosh, founder director of the institute, was focused on immunization against cholera and the effect of animal passage on agglutinating and non-agglutinating strains of Vibrio cholerae. As you know, Vibrio cholerae is the causative bacteria for cholera. Dr. Swachimohan Mukherjee gained international acclaim through his work on cholera first viruses that infect and kill bacteriophage. Many of you know that what is bacteriophage? The virus which kills bacteria is called bacteriophage. Similarly, they found that cholera first bacteria which kills viruses, the bacteria, so cholera first viruses, and then which kill bacteriophage. So using cholera phages, Dr. S. Mukherjee developed a highly successful new phage typing scheme for Vibrio cholerae. He tried to find out viruses, so that's the cholera phage virus, which could kill Vibrio cholerae. And he was pioneered in phage typing scheme. In due course, cholera phage typing was accepted as one of the most reliable technique for epidemiological characterization. So what is called phage typing? You have to culture the bacteria, collect strain, some unknown strains or known strains in a agar plate, and you have some grids, and then you treat with bacteriophages, the viruses, which wants to kill this the bacteria. Then you can identify and screen, and you can go up to the single type of bacteria, and you can isolate the strain. So that was the phage typing. That's why phage typing was very important those days. Nowadays also many people use this. In 1964, WHO identified IICB, actually at the Indian Institute of Medical Research, at the International Center for Cholera Phage Typing. So this was so prestigious event. Dr. S. Mukherjee identified Vibrio cholerae strains responsible for early epidemics in Bengal. This phage typing was used as to categorize seven types and subtypes of the cholera endemic zones of the country. So based on the phage typing, which was discovered by Dr. S. Mukherjee, it was used to subtypes in the cholera endemic zones in that time. This was very useful to find out the routes by which infections travel to distant places from the endemic foci. Dr. S. Mukherjee was first to realize and emphasize on the advantages of an oral vaccine for cholera than the existing perennial vaccine, which could provide modest immunity of short duration. So see, people world didn't imagine at that time, but Dr. S. Mukherjee thought of oral vaccine at that time. Thus, Dr. S. Mukherjee became the pioneer at developing one of the world's first oral vaccines against cholera from non-pathogenic strains isolated from river water. They actually found a non-pathogenic vaccine, a strain of cholera, which doesn't cause cholera, and used for the oral vaccine. In 1964, oral vaccine against cholera was tried in human volunteers. So I want to share this paper, which is published in Journal of Hygiene and Hygiene Camp in 1968 from Great Britain by Dr. S. Mukherjee and P. Bhattacharya. The further studies, the entitled Further Studies on the Development of Live Oral Cholera Vaccine. See the address, Department of Microbiology, Institute of Experimental Medicine, Raja 4 Raja Subodh Malik Road, Calcutta 32. This is the building where we are sitting now. So Dr. Mukherjee studied, they referred the Mukherjee in 1963 paper, studied the possibility of developing live cholera vaccine for administration by the oral route and obtained evidence both by in vitro and in vivo experiments, indicating the suitability for the purpose of an E1 for the Vibrio strain. So this is the strain, E1 taught Vibrio strain. This doesn't cause cholera from the Middle East or from water sources from Calcutta in the absence of cholera. In a subsequent publication, Mukherjee reported the stability of the affluent character of the proposed vaccine strains on repeated propagation in animal or artificial isogenization with phages from virulent cholera cultures. So this is their abstract. They introduced the subject, and finally they said these studies, as well as the results of further work on the pathogenicity and immunizing value. Now we are studying immunizing value of the vaccine, strains, and the nature of immunity produced by in laboratory animals by live vaccination by oral or intra-intestinal routes are reported in this communication. So this is one of the paper. Another paper they have shown the live oral cholera vaccine trial. So this is the landmark event and landmark paper, and it was published in World Health Bulletin 1969. By this group, Dr. Mukherjee and his group. So in order to examine the safety and immunogenic value for human use of this proposed vaccine, a systematic trial has been carried out on 25 human volunteers. So they tested in human. Following oral administration of the vaccine, after neutralization of gastric acidity, the volunteers developed statistically significant increases in the vibrio-cidal antibody. Vibrio-cidal antibody means the vibrio killing ability of the vibrio cholera level. Capro antibodies could also be demonstrated in stool samples within a week of vaccination. Serum and copper antibody levels persisted unchanged during the periods of observation of 6 and 3 months respectively. None of the volunteers suffered an ill effect during the course of the trial, and any ill effect was reported. It has been concluded that the proposed vaccine is safe for human use and likely to protect against infection, although its protective value has still to be confirmed in a field trial. So that was in 1969 and tested in human. It was very successful, and there all the data are also available in various domains. So this is the untold story which I wanted to share, and this is the very landmark picture image which is posted in our board. In the lobby in this building, CSIRICB Jadavpur campus, that the inventors and the doctors, these researchers, they are testing oral cholera vaccine among themselves. And then world follows the oral polio vaccine, and that's a history. So this is the very interesting story, very landmark story I wanted to share and share you. So this is now the building looks like this. This we have a Jadavpur campus and we have a Salt Lake campus, and IICB has passed many years, and we are doing fantastic biomedical research in many areas. Immunology is still there, and infectious disease also is one of our priorities. With this, thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an informative talk. So starting from showing us the discovery of cholera and the establishment of IICB as a national laboratory for biomedical research and infectious diseases. Thank you very much. So we'll move to our next speaker for the webinar, Dr. Shyamal Roy. Dr. Shyamal Roy is PhD in biochemistry from IICB in 1983 and was a postdoctoral fellow at the Department of Biology, MIT Cambridge during 85 till 1988. Dr. Roy was then associated with IICB as scientist from 1990 till 2016 and was the Vice Chancellor of Koch Bihar Panchanan Burma University for a short stint, and is presently an Emeritus Scientist at IICB since 2020. Dr. Roy has several awards and accolades in his name, including the Calcutta University Gold Medal of 1976 and Arthritis Foundation Fellowship Award of MIT Cambridge of 1986, to name a few. Dr. Roy is a J.C. Bose Fellow and also the Fellow of three science academies in India, and also the Fellow of West Bengal Academy of Science and Technology. So with this few lines of introduction, I now invite Dr. Shyamal Roy for his talk in today's session, describing us more about the vaccine development process, its tests and trials, and also the future prospects of this cholera research in India. Over to you, Dr. Roy.
Thank you, Shikha, for your kind introduction. It's a pleasure and privilege to be a part of this Mahotsav. So I'm going to talk about a little bit of the later stories of vaccine development, cholera vaccine development. And also I would like to add a little bit on the Leishmania vaccine development as well. So can I have first slide, please? So next one. So I think Dr. Bandyopadhyay described about live oral cholera vaccine. But if you go further down the memory lane, one Russian scientist, his name is Havkin, 160 years ago, he was born in Russia. And he was a student of Louis Pasteur, as well as trained by Ilya Mishnikov. First showed the concept of attenuation. Attenuation means the loss of virulence. So what he did, he allowed to passage this Vibrio cholerae through peritoneal cavity of guinea pig, and ultimately came up with cholera bacteria which lost its virulence, and ultimately he killed those bacteria and then started inoculating individual. So this is a picture in Calcutta sometime 1894. He came to Calcutta and started, because that time cholera was epidemic, and really his vaccine saved countless people of our country. Next one, please. Now, so he actually came to Calcutta in as a part of the British Crown, and with painstaking research for 2 years, he really developed the vaccine, and ultimately this vaccine was introduced to our countrymen. Next one. Now, he was a great friend of Jamsetji Tata. This is a communication between Jamsetji Tata as well as Havkin. The first letter is basically in relation to visit of Robert Koch, because Robert Koch came to Calcutta, and there is some communication between Havkin and Jamsetji Tata. And second letter, Tata is inviting Havkin for inoculating his family members cholera, for giving the cholera vaccine. He has been invited by Jamsetji Tata. These are the two letters I thought I'll show it to you. Next one. Now, despite all those sanitary issue, treatment, etc., the cholera still continues to be a problem in our country. So this is a 2018 report from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Few districts are seriously affected with cholera, and still it continues to be a problem in our country. Next one, please. So IICB continued its efforts to develop oral cholera vaccine. So jointly with IICB, jointly with IMTEC, developed another live oral cholera vaccine, that is V1.4. And this vaccine was actually, it's an avirulent Vibrio cholerae, and ultimately toxin was introduced to it. And this VA1.4 was used for human trial in Calcutta, and it was a great success, because compared to commercially available vaccines, those are still available. This one dose is sufficient to give good immune response as compared to two doses of vaccine what are commercially available. So therefore, this new vaccine still holds a great promise for using as an effective vaccine for human application. So probably, I don't know whether any pharmaceutical companies are still interested to consider this live oral cholera vaccine, which is definitely very effective, and human trial was done in collaboration with ICMR Institute, NICE at Calcutta, and it was found to be highly effective compared to existing vaccines that are available in use. Next one, please. Now I'll talk a little bit about the DNA vaccine that was developed in our institute for leishmaniasis. Next one, please. Now, leishmaniasis still continues to be a problem in different states of our country. Bihar certainly very much affected. Part of Uttar Pradesh and West Bengal very much affected with the disease. So next one. So this is a recent paper came from Bangladesh, actually with collaborative group. And the red graph showing the incidence of visceral leishmaniasis or Kalajar, left showing the Kalajar cases, Kalajar patient, and they really suffer from immune suppression. Unless treatment is given, the patient is destined to die. What happens after the recovery of the disease? They develop some kind of lesion on the skin. This is called post-Kalajar dermal leishmaniasis. And they can act as a reservoir for the parasites. These patients are apparently healthy. They do not have any problem. Normally, they do not go to the clinicians. But the lesions that you see, they are full of parasites and they can act as a reservoir. So therefore, it is important to bring these people under the fold of treatment. And the incidence of visceral leishmaniasis is decreasing, but at the same time, the blue line that shows that the incidence of post-Kalajar dermal leishmaniasis is increasing. So they can act as a reservoir and can transmit the parasites to new individual, can cause the disease. So therefore, vaccination is important. Next one, please. So this is one of the vaccine that we have developed in collaboration with our European partner, and this was funded by CSIR as well as European Commission. And this is a combination of the five antigens as a DNA vaccine. It was highly effective in the animal model. And we are still trying to get some partner for phase one clinical trial. And still we are continuing our effort to get some pharmaceutical companies. BIRAC was interested to fund, but apparently we did not get any pharmaceutical company to really go for phase one clinical trial for this DNA vaccine that we have developed some time ago. Next one, please. So this is one of the antigen, KMP11 antigen. This is IICB holds a patent on this antigen. And University of York group is combining this KMP11 antigen with another antigen. And then they are putting in the adenovirus expression system. And already they have done phase two clinical trial against PKDL in Sudan. So our antigen KMP11 is already in clinical use in Sudan. So this is the paper that came out from the Sudanese group using this combination of antigen KMP11 and another antigen to treat PKDL cases in Sudan. So definitely KMP11 is an important antigen as other people are using it. So hopefully if we get support from pharmaceutical companies and other agencies, we can take our antigen for the phase one clinical trial. Next one. So another antigen in collaboration with National Institute of Immunology, New Delhi, Amitabh Mukhopadhyay, we have another antigen hemoglobin receptor, which shows a very highly effective against experimental visceral leishmaniasis infection. So these are the two vaccines that are ready for phase one clinical trial. And hopefully if we get some support from different agencies, we can take these vaccines further. With this, I stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your talk. So it's a pleasure to have you here. We'll have a few questions from the viewers. We'll see.
Sure.
So we have a question from Mr. Komu Nagaya. So he wants to know, to the best of our knowledge, the only vaccine approved internationally as polio drop, it is polio drop. Is this oral cholera vaccine approved internationally by WHO?
This is one vaccine that is, yeah. I think, Santa Biotech. They have one oral cholera vaccine. So Santa Biotech is marketing that vaccine, oral cholera vaccine.
Okay. So like after this, we have vaccine on polio. So that is also, means the work has been done at IACB. I'm just curious to know about it.
No, not
about the activity. But okay.
We actually wanted to tell you that the concept of oral vaccine, yeah, that is developed by IACB.
Okay. So these kind of vaccines, again, just like as we see in COVID cases, do they have any age criteria or like to administer?
For
cholera vaccine, I'm talking about. Yeah.
No, actually, oral cholera vaccine can be given to any age, but for the rotavirus, people showed that nutrition has a very important role to play to produce immune response against rotaviral vaccines. So therefore, but it can be given, but vaccine efficacy is also dependent on the nutritional condition of the given individual. So okay, success story is also dependent on the nutrition of the of subject. That given subject.
So like this rotavirus vaccine that you are saying, so that is almost essential. Is this cholera vaccine also listed as an essential vaccine in the Indian Medical Association somewhere? Or it depends on the places where the epidemic or pandemic.
I think it is. I don't know whether it is a mandatory to get cholera vaccine or not. But during our childhood days, I can still recall that every year we had to get cholera vaccine in those days. But now probably it is not that is the case anymore.
Yeah, because we have not seen these days.
Yeah, because of the improved sanitation and water quality, and this is not now very frequent, the cholera outbreak.
Yeah. So what are the new prospects of any kind of research in this area? Any new activity, new research going on cholera vaccine? Are we connected?
Yeah, you're connected.
Yeah. So any new points to share here with the audience?
Regarding cholera or leishmania, which area you
are? Sir, leishmania is also fine. So any new research point of view here to share with the audience?
Leishmania, first of all, the DNA vaccine that you have showing a great promise. And hopefully if we get support, because already preclinical toxicity studies, everything has been done. So it is ready to go for phase one clinical trial. So provided we get some funding and support, so we can take this DNA vaccine for phase one clinical trial. Because it is extremely important now the BL cases are decreasing, but PKDL cases are still increasing. So they can act as a reservoir and can transmit the parasites to normal individuals. So therefore, it is high time to develop a vaccine to as a prophylactic vaccine. It should be given so that in future, the disease can be under control. So in 1960s, when drug was discovered for leishmaniasis, it was again done in Calcutta by another Indian scientist, Upendranath Brahmachari. He discovered the pentavalent antimonial for treatment of Kalazar, where the entire Gangetic Plain and Brahmaputra Valley was a valley of shadow of death. That time he introduced the drug for the treatment of Kalazar or leishmaniasis. So he was nominated for Nobel Prize a couple of times, but he did not get it for various reasons. So up to 1960s, the disease was almost under control and became a rare clinical entity. But suddenly, in 1976 or 1977, 80,000 cases reported in Bihar and a lot of deaths. So similarly, disease can flare up at any given time. And so therefore, one vaccine is important, and prophylactically, if it given, then probably we can control this kind of sudden epidemic if it happens. Because in 18, at that time, a lot of people died of leishmaniasis, because all the pharmaceutical companies stopped producing or manufacturing that drug because there was no disease at all. So therefore, we should be ready for this kind of incidences.
Yeah, definitely. So even the recent COVID pandemic, so it has made our laboratory to act fast and come up with solutions. So even IICB has acted a lot. And so if we have some short talk on that from Dr. Bandyopadhyay regarding a very short talk on
that. Yeah, we have many. Like, so we participated immediately when DIGIT started calling us from the very first day to for COVID mitigation. You know, on 23rd March, when lockdown was declared in 2020, 25th March, I got a call from a hospital, Army Hospital in Calcutta. They wanted real-time PCR machine to deploy there. To get deployed their facility. At that time, our hospital setup, clinical setup establishment didn't have real-time PCR machine. Neither did they know about the real-time PCR mechanism and the techniques. So we deployed our own machine, real-time PCR machine there, because at that time cases were rising and they wanted to test, because at ICMR told that test. So testing was necessary, but the facility was not enough. So we deployed machine and we trained them. Our students went there in the hospital, trained the person, the technical person. Their technical person again trained other people in Udhampur and other hospitals after getting training from us. So our whatever, subsequently we shared with other hospital also. We created a facility in Raigonj Medical College in the rural Bengal of Bengal, because the state government approached us to set up a whole facility there for COVID testing facility. We shared many machines, not only the RT-PCR machine, other facilities like minus 80 center refrigerator, centrifuge machine, and others. So we set up that. Still, it is there. And so they tested with our machines 70,000, 50,000 patients from West Bengal. We also engaged and also participated in our antiviral mission project, CSI mission project with IICT, Hyderabad, and many other institutes. And you know, the plasma therapy was tried by our Dr. Deepamal Ganguly. That is also one landmark event. And so many ways we tried and get involved with COVID mitigation from our CSI, under the leadership of our active disease, Dr. Shekhar Simande.
Yeah,
so we made a video and shared with CSIR about this. 5 minutes video is there. And also now we are a part of the INSACOG, so sequencing the viral virus. INSACOG, that is the national mission for sequencing the mutants. And we have participated there. We are submitting our sequences from the nearby hospitals. We collect samples from the hospitals.
Thank you so much, sir. So it's very nice to know about the efforts of our laboratory fighting and like coming up with a solution to tackle this kind of medical scenarios. So thank you both of you, Dr. Bandyopadhyay and Dr. Roy, for your talks and comments. So it was great listening to both of you and to know about the contributions of our labs in disease cure and control process. So we have almost reached the end of the session. Before closing, I request Dr. Shivshankar Roy, Senior Principal Scientist and Head of the Cell Biology and Physiology Division of CSIR IICB, to kindly present the vote of thanks for today's webinar. Over to you, Dr. Roy.
Thank you, Dr. Shika. The involvement and achievement of CSIR IICB on cholera research, especially on the development of first vaccine oral vaccine against cholera in 1959 has been described by Professor Bondhopadhyay and Professor Roy very lucidly and in a very elaborate way. In spite of the advancement in clinical management of the disease, cholera still remains a deadly one in many parts of the world, also in India. Even today, several lakhs of people are infected and thousands of people die each year in India due to cholera. CSIR ICB took the initiative for the development of oral cholera vaccine using the right strategy long ago and showed the path to the scientific community towards successfully address the issue, and the concept is still valid. ICB's initiative on Leishmania vaccine development has also been discussed, which appears to be a great promise. In this respect, I'd like to show our gratitude and heartfelt thanks to Professor Shekhar C. Mande, Director General CSIR and Secretary DSIR, Government of India, for supporting such an useful weekly webinar series to mark the milestones of Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav and CSIR at 80 that showcases the success stories of different CSIR laboratories. In this context, the Science Communication and Dissemination Directorate of CSIR is playing a major role to successfully organize such useful seminars. I would like to thank Dr. Geeta Bani Rayasam, Head SCDD CSIR, for her cooperation to organizing this webinar. I would also thank Dr. G. Mahesh and Dr. Shikha of the SCDD for taking essential role in organizing the seminar. I would like to also thank Dr. Nita Khalko and Dr. Arti Grover from CSIR IICB to help in organizing the seminar, and also the team of computer division who are engaged in organizing this webinar. My heartfelt thanks goes to today's speaker, Professor Arun Bondhopadhyay, Professor Shyamal Roy, to beautifully explaining the role of CSIR IICB in the development of first oral cholera vaccine. Finally, I thank to all the viewers of today's seminar. Thanks to all. Jai Hind.
Thank you very much. Goodbye, everyone. Take care. Namaskar.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for joining.
Thank you.